So, I don't want to be here this morning. You don't want me to be here this morning, but here we are again. The cases across the country are spiking massively. We are facing a winter that's going to drive people inside more and more, and we're really at risk of seeing caseloads go up and hospitals get overwhelmed and more loved ones dying. So we need to do everything we can right now to slow the spread of COVID-19, to stop this spike in its tracks. If you were planning to see friends this weekend, maybe don't. If there was a birthday party or a gathering for dinner you were thinking about doing, don't do it. We're in a moment right now, or even with all the sacrifices I know Canadians have been making over these past 10 months, we are now going to have to really tighten up once again. This is frustrating, because I know we've all heard stories of people who've thrown up their hands and are not doing their part anymore. People who have stopped wearing masks, or people who are going out more than they should. And it's tempting for all of us to say, okay, well, maybe I can loosen up a bit more too. But the reality is, we need to go in the opposite direction. If there are people out there not following the rules when we know we need to, well, then those of us who need to are going to have to do even more. Because it's the future of our country. It's the future of our children. It's the future of our loved ones and our seniors. It's our economy. It's our businesses. It's everything all together. We're going to need to have to do this for another few weeks, for another few months, and we can begin to see the other side of this. We can do this. We've done it before. We know what to do. We understand this virus much better than before. We need to reduce our contacts. We need to do it right now. Je suis pas ici parce que ça me tente de l'être. Et je sais que ça vous tente pas de me voir ici, devant ma maison encore une fois, en train de dire, il va falloir qu'on fasse des sacrifices, mais c'est exactement où on en est rendu. On est en train de voir une montée fulgurante des cas, ici au Canada, partout au Canada, comme on le voit partout à travers le monde. Et nous savons ce que nous devons faire. Nous devons de suivre les consignes de la santé publique. Nous devons de réduire nos contacts, de faire des choix judicieux, attentifs, de ne pas se rassembler avec des amis, de ne pas fêter des anniversaires, de rester virtuel, de rester à la maison le plus possible. On est rendu au moment où on va devoir, encore une fois, se resserrer pendant quelques semaines pour bloquer, pour arrêter cette éclosion de la COVID-19. Et si on agit bien pour les semaines à venir, ben ça va peut-être être un peu plus facile pour les prochains mois. Mais je vais vous dire la vérité, les prochains mois vont être difficiles. On s'en va à l'hiver. On va être encore plus à l'intérieur. On va être encore plus limité. La COVID-19 va pouvoir se propager plus facilement à l'intérieur. Et donc, il va falloir qu'on fasse attention. Ça fait 10 mois qu'on le fait, que les gens font les bonnes choses, qu'on a démontré qu'on peut contrôler ce virus. Et bien, on est rendu maintenant dans un moment où il va falloir qu'on le fasse encore une fois et encore plus que ce qu'on faisait dans les semaines passées. Et c'est frustrant parce que on entend des histoires de ceux qui ne sont pas en train de suivre les consignes, qui se mettent à risque, qui nous mettent tous à risque. Et même si ça nous tente de faire comme eux, on sait qu'on ne peut pas. Que ceux d'entre nous qui suivent les consignes vont devoir en faire encore plus. Et c'est pas juste. C'est pas juste pour personne. Mais on sait ce qu'il faut faire. On sait que c'est le moment, maintenant, de se rassembler et de faire ce qu'on a pu faire au printemps. We need to do what we're doing to protect jobs, to support businesses, and to keep Canadians safe. We need to work together, all of us, as a team. Yesterday, I had a briefing with Dr. Tam, Dr. Ngu, Minister Haidu, and the leaders of the opposition to discuss the current situation. All orders of government must come together to stop the spread of this virus. This was something I discussed last week with the premiers at our 21st virtual First Minister's meeting since the pandemic began. Across the country, we're seeing premiers and mayors making very tough choices to go into further shutdowns. And I know how hard that is, and I want them to know that they have my support, our support as a federal government. The best way to protect the economy is to get the virus under control. Doing things to protect people's health is the best way to minimize lasting damage to the economy. You know, in the beginning, we thought of this as a contradiction, that the things we need to do to keep us safe are things that are actually hurting the economy. That was how we framed that first wave of shutdowns. But we actually now know better from seeing what's happened around the world, from seeing how Canadians have made it through that first wave and through this second wave that's ongoing. Doing the things that protect our health are actually the best things to do to protect our economy. Going into lockdown and supporting businesses while we're in that lockdown is a better way of ensuring their success in a few months, in a few years, than trying to tough through a virus that is running around unchecked. We know that we need to be there for each other, and the federal government is going to continue to be there to help businesses that are impacted by these shutdowns. That's a promise I made from the beginning, and it's a promise we're keeping. This isn't the fault of any individual business, and we're going to do everything we can to get them to the other side of this. That's why it was so important last night that our government's bill providing unprecedented levels of supports to Canadian businesses became law. I want to thank all parliamentarians for working together to get this through. These support measures include a new rent subsidy for businesses which will go directly to tenants, not through landlords. Up to 65% of rent can be covered for small businesses affected by COVID-19. And if your business is facing a public health lockdown, then we're also providing an additional 25% rent subsidy through the new lockdown support. Combined with the rent assistance, hard-hit businesses could get a rent subsidy of up to 90%. Canadian businesses can begin applying for these new measures as of Monday, and they will be retroactive until the beginning of October. Lastly, this new law also means that the wage subsidy has been extended until June of next year, securing jobs and support for workers right across the country. This program has been a lifeline for millions of Canadians. So we're making sure people continue to get this support. Go to canada.ca/coronavirus to find out what supports are there to help you. Je tiens à remercier tous les parlementaires d'avoir contribué à l'adoption rapide des nouvelles mesures de soutien aux entreprises proposées par notre gouvernement. Ces mesures comprennent une nouvelle subvention pour le loyer commercial qui sera versée directement aux locataires et non par l'entremise des propriétaires. La subvention pourra couvrir jusqu'à 65 % du loyer des petites entreprises touchées par la COVID-19 et si votre entreprise est visée par un ordre de confinement, vous pourrez recevoir une subvention supplémentaire de 25 % pour votre loyer grâce à la nouvelle mesure de soutien en cas de confinement. Ensemble, ces deux mesures pourraient couvrir jusqu'à 90 % du loyer des entreprises durement touchées. Ceux qui en ont besoin pourront faire leur demande dès lundi matin. De plus, la subvention salariale sera quant à elle prolongée jusqu'en juin 2020. Pour obtenir de l'information, rendez-vous sur le site web canada.ca/coronavirus. Just like our government is here to support businesses, we'll also continue to send additional targeted support to areas that are seeing concerning situations with rising cases. Last week, I announced specific support for Indigenous communities in Manitoba. Today, we're providing over $120 million in immediate funding to regions that are affected by outbreaks in Saskatchewan and Alberta. This will be used to support public health measures, food security, and other surge capacity needs. Minister Miller and Dr. Wong will have more to say at their regular update later today, but the bottom line is that we will do everything we can to keep people safe right across the country. À l'heure actuelle, on compte 52 000 cas actifs de COVID-19 au Canada et 1800 hospitalisations. Plus de 11 000 personnes sont décédées à cause de ce virus. Plus tôt aujourd'hui, la Dr Tam a présenté des projections de ce à quoi on pourrait s'attendre si on ne contrôle pas la propagation actuelle. Si on n'agit pas maintenant, on pourrait compter jusqu'à 20 000 nouveaux cas par jour d'ici la fin décembre. Et si on augmente nos contacts au lieu de les réduire, ce nombre pourrait devenir encore beaucoup plus élevé. Il faut être réaliste. La seule façon de renverser la tendance, c'est de réduire nos contacts en personne. Si vous n'avez pas besoin de quitter votre domicile, restez chez vous. Réduisez vos contacts. Aidez-nous à briser la deuxième vague et à sauver des vies. Earlier today, Dr. Tam presented the updated COVID-19 modeling for Canada. Canada could have up to 20,000 new cases daily by the end of December if we don't limit or reduce our contacts now. And if we loosen and increase our contacts, we could see tens of thousands more. I know this isn't what people wanted to see, to hear, but we have to be realistic about the situation. We're seeing huge spikes in places like Ontario, Manitoba, Saskatchewan, Alberta, and Nunavut, with a record number of hospitalizations across the country. Overwhelmed hospitals are a problem for people who need COVID-19 care. But it's also an issue for people who need other care, whether it's cancer treatments or emergency surgery. And each new case of COVID-19, every extra week that goes on with more cases, puts added pressure on our frontline workers and our healthcare system workers. Think about it. Our doctors, nurses, personal support workers, orderlies, hospital staff, they've been on the front lines for almost 10 months now, putting in incredibly long hours, being creative in how they can save people and protect people while at the same time trying to keep themselves safe, while at the same time having the same worries that each of us have about our loved ones, about our kids and schools, about our parents and our grandparents. And yet they keep showing up every single day to be there for us, putting their health, their lives, and in many cases, their families' lives on the line to keep us safe. And they're tired. They have been heroes. They have been going above and beyond anything they might have thought they were signing up for. We need to help them. We need to give them a break. We need to stop this spike in cases. We need to think about them as we think about our loved ones who need medical help, who are vulnerable to COVID-19, as we think about the damage this is doing to families and to communities across the country. We need to step up now, all of us. The numbers show that right now, more of the most vulnerable Canadians are getting COVID-19, including seniors. And outbreaks in long-term care homes and Indigenous communities are rapidly rising. The only way we can reverse the tide is if we immediately reduce the number of people each of us come into contact with. If you live in a region that is experiencing a surge in cases, stay home if you can and avoid all non-essential travel. to employers who can do so, please make arrangements for your employees to once again work from home. And if you don't need to, don't leave your home. And if you haven't already, join the over 5.3 million Canadians who've already downloaded the COVID Alert app. 5.3 million Canadians. That's over a quarter of all the Canadians in jurisdictions that have used the app who own smartphones. We are on our way to making a difference with this app, because every use alerts other people that they need to be careful. And it's an addition to contact tracing of nurses and public health professionals calling up to see who you might have come into contact with. This will catch people you didn't even know you were in contact with. It's an easy thing to do, to download the app for free. It's an easy thing to do, to take a moment once you receive a COVID-19 positive diagnosis to plug it in. Many provinces give you that code right away as soon as you get your positive case, so please plug it in immediately. Some other places require you to make a phone call, which will take a minute to get the code to plug it into the app, but doing our part with this tool will make a huge difference. And I said that's 25%, over 25% of all people in affected in participating provinces that have the app and have smartphones. Of course, there's two provinces that haven't yet made the app available through their healthcare system. I want to directly touch on that right now for people in Alberta and BC. If you live in Alberta and BC, you can already still download the app for free yourself and put it on your phone. And there's two reasons to do that right now as we go through this second wave. First reason is I'm still hopeful that the local health systems will put together a system where they can give you that one-time code, which will allow diagnoses in those provinces to be plugged into the system to alert people. But secondly, from the minute you download that app, it starts to work in tracing your contacts with people who also have the app. So if you're in Alberta and you come into contact inadvertently with someone who then goes home to Saskatchewan and gets tested positive, you'll be alerted that you should maybe get yourself checked. It can work even if your health system isn't yet on board. It's free, it absolutely protects your privacy, and it's an extra tool we have at a time where we need to be using all the tools we have to keep ourselves safe. That's what we need to do. Il y a plus de 5 millions de personnes qui ont téléchargé l'application Alerte COVID. Alors j'encourage tout le monde de le faire. Et une fois que vous l'aviez, utilisez-le. Si ça vous avertit que vous aviez été en contact, faites un suivi, isolez-vous, faites-vous tester. Et si vous recevez un diagnostic positif, poinçonnez le code à 8 chiffres pour avertir ceux que vous connaissez et ceux que vous ne connaissez pas qui devraient se faire vérifier eux aussi. C'est gratuit, ça respecte votre vie privée. Et on a maintenant plus de 25% de la population éligible qui ont des téléphones intelligents qui peuvent, qui l'utilisent. C'est un outil de plus et ces jours-ci, on a besoin de tous nos outils pour passer à travers cette pandémie et cette crise. Je compte sur vous tous. So download the app. Help us beat this second wave, save lives, because that's what's at stake. Every person that we lose to this virus is someone who has family and friends who loved them, who had plans for tomorrow and things they still wanted to do. I think about the woman in Toronto who survived the Holocaust and recently passed away from COVID-19. Forced to flee her home during the war, she and her family ended up at a labor camp in Siberia. She made it through and started a new life in Canada. She got married and had kids who loved her dearly. So to her loved ones, my deepest condolences for your loss. And to the thousands of other families who've lost someone because of COVID-19, my thoughts are with you. Every loss is a tragedy. And each story reminds us of what is at stake in this fight against the pandemic. Our parents and grandparents, our friends and neighbors, people who give so much joy to those around him, people who are loved. Je sais que c'est pas facile, mais on doit pouvoir se compter les uns sur les autres. Depuis 10 mois maintenant, nos travailleurs de première ligne dans notre système de santé font un travail extraordinaire pour nous aider. Nos médecins, nos infirmières, tous ceux qui travaillent dans nos hôpitaux, dans notre système de santé, sont là pour nous, travaillent de longues heures, font face à des défis incroyables et imprévus, et font tout ça pendant qu'ils gèrent les mêmes stress que nous tous. Est-ce que je vais tomber malade? Est-ce que je vais ramener cette maladie à mes enfants? Comment est-ce que mes enfants vont passer à travers? Comment est-ce que je vais pouvoir passer à travers? Ces mêmes stress que nous vivons tous, eux, ils vivent en plus de leur responsabilité de nous sauver tous et chacun. Ils se sont dédiés à ça avec leur vie. Ils ont choisi ce parcours, mais il n'y a personne qui a choisi cette pandémie. Et nous, nous devons de faire tout ce qu'on peut faire pour les aider, pour leur donner du répit, pour arrêter cette éclosion des cas. En tant que gouvernement, nous allons continuer d'être là pour vous tous, avec l'aide directe du fédéral, pour les travailleurs, pour les familles, pour les entreprises, et ça va continuer. Parce qu'ensemble, on va passer à travers cette crise. Si vous devez rester à la maison, on va être là pour vous. Si vous devez fermer boutique temporairement, on va être là pour vous. On continue d'écouter ces médecins et ces experts et on prend toutes les mesures nécessaires, qu'il soit question d'équipement de protection individuelle ou de vaccins, pour que les Canadiens puissent rester en sécurité. So in the coming days, I will be working from home as much as possible and I'll be addressing you again from these steps next week. Now is the time for each of us to once again rise to the occasion and do our part. We know what to do, we know how hard it is, but we know it works because we did it this spring. Together, let's bend the curve and keep each other safe. This weekend, I'll be virtually joining the G20 as part of our government's work to respond to this virus at home and abroad. And on that note, today I can also confirm that the Canada-US border restrictions have been extended until at least December 21st. We will continue to work with our American counterparts to keep people safe on both sides of the border. Je peux confirmer que les restrictions à la frontière entre le Canada et les États-Unis seront prolongées jusqu'au 21 décembre. Et à ce sujet, on continue de travailler avec nos homologues américains pour assurer la sécurité des gens des deux côtés de la frontière. On continue aussi de collaborer avec nos partenaires de partout ailleurs dans le monde, non seulement pour protéger les Canadiens, mais pour rebâtir une économie forte qui fonctionne pour tous. Aujourd'hui, j'ai pris la parole lors de la réunion des dirigeants de l'APEC et j'ai discuté de notre réponse à la pandémie, la nécessité de rebâtir des économies résilientes et du travail qu'on fait pour lutter contre les changements climatiques. Cette fin de semaine, je vais m'entretenir avec les autres dirigeants du G20 pour parler de notre lutte commune contre la COVID-19 et de ce qu'on fait pour protéger les emplois et relancer nos économies. So I've shared a lot of information this morning, but here's the bottom line. We have a long winter ahead. As the weather drives us indoors, we really are in danger of seeing more transmission and far too many more deaths. It'll be tough, but we know what we have to do. Wear a mask, keep your distance, download the app and use it, avoid gatherings of all sizes, and know that together, being there for each other, we will get through this. Merci.